Good morning. Glad to have those who could join us here today, as well as those who are joining us online as we continue in our season of Advent and our preparations for Christmas today. As we get ourselves going, I'd like to take a moment and let us set our hearts and our minds in an attitude of prayer and praise to come before God this morning. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for today. We thank you, Lord, for the blessing of your gifts upon us. We thank you, Lord, for the guidance that you give. Let your guidance be with us now. Guide us in what we do. That in what we do today and in who we are, it may be a blessing in your sight. In your name we pray, O Lord. Amen. As we get ourselves going and not doing a learning moment so much today as a few reminders, we're again doing the Bible study on Wednesday at 11 o'clock. Do it here in the sanctuary for all who can join us.
Tuesday.
Did I say, what did I say?
Wednesday.
I have Tuesday written down, sorry. I'll blame it on fog or something like that. Tuesday at 11 o'clock here in the sanctuary. I look forward to seeing you all that can join with us. A little note, next Sunday we're going to be having a Christmas show by the kids as they help bring the message of Christmas to us. It's going to be interesting and a little exciting for me, a little different because we still have to maintain our distancing stuff. So, you've got to come out and see the work they're doing and trying to make sure that that gets together. So we'll be doing one during the worship time at 11 o'clock, and then the plan to do one outside in the evening at 5 o'clock. So we hope that you can come and join for one or both of those services if you can, and see the hard work that the kids are putting in and the teachers and all are putting in with them to help make sure that they're ready to present this message that God has given. So I encourage you to come be a part of that. As it is Advent, we have our Advent wreath up here. We have our first candle lit to mark the beginning of Advent. We're going to light our second candle now. I had a lighter up here. There. Yep, okay. Come on up and... Our lists are long, even in this strange mess that we live in these days. And we want to do it right. We want to be safe, but we want to be able to enjoy the season. We've got work to do to put right what has gone wrong, to heal what is broken, to mend the relationships, and to prepare for the company that will come. The prophet Isaiah reminded us that there is work to be done. Prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. When God comes in, then healing is to be found. But we need to make that way. We need to open the door into our lives. So we light these candles as a sign of our faith that the God that we worship is not far from us, and that we can clear the way for that God to come and to dwell within us. We light these candles in faith that company is coming. O come, Emmanuel. We have our music presentation from for today. It's a His Name medley. So Paulette, if you share with us. Thank you. Thank you, Paula. Our scripture reading for today comes from the Gospel of Mark, the first chapter. Read the first through the eighth verses. Mark's a good gospel. Mark 1, beginning with verse 1, we hear these words. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, and make his path straight.' John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, 'The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me, and I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit.' This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you for your Spirit upon us now. Let the word that we share, the word we hear, be your word for us. In your name we pray, O Lord. Amen. I remember when I was in seminary and we were talking about the New Testament, we were beginning to talk about the Gospels and how they tell the stories. And the first thing that our instructor asked us to do was to turn in the Gospel of Mark to the birth story. And we hadn't really thought about it. You could see a lot of us, we were flipping it, we were like, okay, it's not, hey, he doesn't have it in here. The Gospels are telling a story about the importance of God and how God has interacted in people's lives and making sure that people understand the purpose of Jesus coming. Mark wants to get right to that right away. Mark doesn't start with the earlier stories. He doesn't start with a birth story. He jumps right into God has sent Jesus, and there's John in the wilderness. There's this person out there who looks weird. You think about that for a minute. Think about people that you have seen maybe in church, maybe around you in the community, maybe in the store sometimes, and the way they're dressed, and you've gone, huh, that's an interesting choice, right? You've seen some people like that once in a while. When my daughter was little and she was at preschool, the preschool she attended was at the church that I was serving. And so she insisted on being dropped off like all the other kids. So I would drive up and come through the loop and let her out. And then I would pull right back around and park. And I would come in, and as I was coming in at times, there would be days when the teachers, as I'm going by, went, well, we see Dad let her get dressed today. Because she might have polka dots and stripes. And I'm like, well, whatever, you know. So they would always blame me for it. I don't know why. We always blame the guys for not being able to dress their kids properly. But she had clothes on and was there. And so I was excited about that. But think about some of the people that might come to church. What might really throw you off? We had a guy that came to my home church, and he had a robe that looked like it might, like he might have been in a production or something from there. He wore sandals. He carried a staff with him. He lived under the bridge near the church. But he would come in, and you could see people in the church who were, ugh, not too certain about this guy. Maybe we need to think about, somebody should suggest something to him or whatever. There was that kind of feeling about it. So here, the first person that we see at work in Mark's gospel is John. John appears out of the wilderness. There's this kind of immediacy in Mark's stories. John, boom, appears in the wilderness. And he has this message that he's proclaiming about repentance and forgiveness. And people are coming to see him. And Mark says he's clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locust and wild honey. Ew. Let me be fair. I've never eaten locust, so I can't tell you what exactly they taste like. And if you want me to tell you, you're going to have to find somebody else, because I don't see me eating wild locust anytime soon. But there he is, this figure, and that's going to draw a certain amount of attention to people. But the first thing Mark tells you about him is not the way he's dressed, but the message that he is bringing. He's bringing this message, this call for repentance, and the people are coming from all over the countryside to come see him. They're responding to this message that he has given to them. His clothing, the image that he projects, that Mark describes, is one of the prophets of old. And prophets, in our biblical understanding of prophets, are not somebody who's a fortune teller. They're not somebody who can look down the road and tell you, well, this thing's going to happen. The lottery numbers for next week are all these kind of things. The prophets of the Bible are the people who are coming to bring a message from God to someone who really needs to hear it. They have a prophetic voice. They're speaking and sharing what God wants people to know. And John comes and tells people and says, what God wants you to know is that you need to repent. You need to think about what you have been doing and not simply be sorry about it, but to address it, to work on it, to change the way you live and who you are. We have the quote from Isaiah, I am sending my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness. Prepare the way of the Lord and make his path straight. It's important that you have this story of someone who is coming out of the wilderness. The wilderness is a scary place. Now, you might say, yeah, I'm not as concerned about the wilderness. Or if I said wilderness, what image you might have in your mind. But in this time, this era, the wilderness is a place of fear. It's a place where there is danger. Robbers are there. Death is there. Wild animals are there. Wilderness is not a place you just wander into. Wilderness is a place you try to get through or get around as quickly as you can. When the people of Israel had been taken away in captivity and the preparing to come back, they were going to be able to come back home. The call was to make straight the paths in the wilderness. There was going to be a way to get through all of this to get back home. We hear this message again coming from John. Prepare the ways, the path straight through the wilderness. You have to be ready, he says, to hear God's message. I'm beginning to tell you some about it. I'm beginning to give you this message about the call to repentance and how you need to live. But what I'm sharing with you is nothing compared to the one who comes after me. I'm doing this baptism with water. I'm doing this to help you understand. There's no magic in that. There's no magic trick involved there. It's a symbol of the need to wash clean, to be something different. But he says, when the one that is coming after me shows up, the one who, if you're impressed by the things that I have to say, wait until you hear him speak. I'm not even able to worthy of untying his sandals. That's the lowest of the low jobs. I'm not even worthy to do that. He's going to come with power and with the Spirit. That word is important for us today. It seems like everywhere right now is the wilderness. It can seem like everything that we encounter is dangerous. And we're looking for a bit of hope, a bit of understanding of a way to move through it. When we hear the story in Genesis of the creation, there is chaos until God's Spirit moves across the water to move to make things right, to begin that process of shaping things into something new. So when John says that Jesus comes with the Spirit, that's not just anything. That's an important message to tell people, that the one who worked in creation to shape things, to make them right, is at work again. He's coming, and that Spirit is going to change things around you. It's going to bring about a new era, a new time, a new way. It's going to bring hope. It's not that Mark doesn't care about the birth of Jesus. It's that Mark is in such a hurry to tell us about why all of this is important. Mark's gospel has that kind of just pacing. It moves. John doesn't just wander out of the wilderness. John appears. He's there. Where he talks about the coming of Jesus as something that is moving along later. But that call to repentance is something that is very important, and it's important that we understand. Repentance is not just thinking about how I feel bad about something. Repentance is not just I feel sorry. I didn't get that right. Repentance is about understanding that and moving forward to change the way we live, to change the actions, to begin to look at how we might be different than we are today. If we are missing out on that, we talk about the importance of understanding the reason for the season. We talk about the importance of understanding that Christmas is about the birth of Christ. But if we don't understand why it's important that Christ is here, if all we simply want to say about Christmas is it's important because a baby showed up, we're missing still a part of it. It's a call to us. It's a call to us of what is going to happen. It's a call to us of what to be prepared for. It's a call to us to say there is something important about what we do today and about how we live. John doesn't say we're going to get it all right from this moment on, and Jesus would never say that about us. Jesus knows we have that need for help. But it's that beginning step, that's called that recognition of, I need to think about how I've been living. I need to give some thought to what I have done, and I need to give thought of what I should be doing. Where are the ways that I have not met what I should be doing today? And the trick is, we know what we should be doing. That spirit that Jesus brings is also within us. That spirit speaks to us and calls to us and says, hey, you need to really think about what you've done. And let's think about how we might move forward into something new and something different. So as we are in the process of getting ready for Christmas, as we're trying to make sure that we have our decorations up, as we're working to figure out how we're going to get our presents in a day and age where it is difficult to get to the stores, we also want to take that time to think about who we are, who we're supposed to be, to own those mistakes so that we might find the ways with God's help to move forward into a new way of living. I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. John is calling to us to help us to know that somebody amazing and great and wonderful is coming. And we need to work at making that path straight to our heart so that God may find his way in, and that we may then realize that God has been in there the whole time. And it is not we who are inviting God in, but it is we who are coming to understand that God invites us into a new life. Beloved, let me encourage you to spend this time preparing for the coming of the Christ child and the message that Christ brings through God, the need for a new life, for a new hope, for a new promise for tomorrow. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you for the gift of today. We thank you, O Lord, for the gracious gift of your Spirit. Guide us, help us, teach us that we may be yours. Let us hear the call to be ready. And let us strive to do so. In your name we pray, O Lord. Amen. Today we're going to take part in our communion service. We'll do the beginning part in here. As we are finishing, we will take the elements out, and you may take them as you do, and we'll take and partake of them outside as we have that chance in a socially distanced way as we prepare to honor God in what we do and how we strive to keep one another safe. Lord our God, we lift up our hearts to you and we offer our thanks to you, O Lord. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. 1,000 years is but a day in your sight. You are steadfast and sure. You come with might to protect us. Like a shepherd, you feed us and hold us gently in your arms to give us comfort in the times of trial. So, Lord, hear us as we praise your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, whose coming was foretold by your prophet John in the wilderness. He prepared us for Jesus, who came to give us life. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to you. He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ has risen, and Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. For we have been baptized not just with water, but with water and the Spirit. O Lord, we ask you to be with the world around us today as we look in hope for ways to continue to deal with this pandemic, but in hope of vaccines and the chance to move forward into a new, more normal life. We ask you, O Lord, to be with our country as we work through this time of transition in our government, that your grace would be upon all of those who are involved, and that your guidance would be with our leaders. We lift up to you this day, O Lord, those who are doing without for this season, for those who have been struck by financial difficulties, who have suffered so much and are in need of that helping hand. Let us, O Lord, find the ways to be the helping hands that you want us to be in the world. We pray for those, O Lord, who suffer silently, for those whose pain is not recognized because it is something internal. We ask for your Spirit to touch each one of those people and help us to know and to see that pain that we do not see, that we might share in compassion with them as well. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at the heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and the Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Father Almighty, now and forever. Amen. Let us, as God's children, share in the prayer that he has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I remind you, as we go forward, you'll be taking one cup. Our wafer, our bread, is in the top. Obviously, our juice is in the bottom. We'll wait until we're outside and we have a chance to be together as we are socially apart, so that we can partake of this together, one with another. I invite you, as we share in this, to think about God's grace that is at work in our lives always.